Okay, thanks everyone for coming. I'm very excited to actually start talking about this research because I've been working on it for about at least 6 months, maybe 9 months with Andrew and also with Dr. Giuseppe Muschelli at the University of Surrey, who's a professor of economics. And he's advised us on all the econometric models that we've actually used for the analysis. And unfortunately, as Sarah kind of mentioned, Andrew's ill today, and so he's stuck with me. And I'm not an econometrician by trade. I'm kind of very new to econometrics, but it's been quite a steep learning curve. So this is a relatively simple explanation of the econometrics that we've used, but I can kind of field any questions that you have and also take questions away as well. Cool. Okay, so as most of you know, the majority of interventions you have in government and also in NHS England are staggered in nature. Okay, so it's very rare that you kind of create something new as a new policy and it's all simultaneously rolled out at the same point in time. In reality, it is rolled out at different points in time. And this is especially true for NHS England providers where there is asymmetric funding and there's funding constraints. Providers are able to implement different things at different points in time, depending on how much funding they have to implement that at the point in time. And this is especially true for electronic patient record systems. So you can kind of see, although it is a little bit cut off, you can see on the right-hand side over time, the blue dots are turning pink. And this is essentially showing that kind of between 2017 and 2022, these large providers are adopting EPR systems from a position of not actually having an electronic patient record. Now, there's a number of key problems with staggered, with actually building econometric models to deal with staggered interventions. Now, typically, you will have used a two-way fixed effect econometric model. Recent literature, so from 2020 onwards, and it's kind of widely accepted in academia now, is that that can lead to biased estimates because essentially, if you have a large number of treated providers, econometric models for a two-way fixed effect model is unable to distinguish between earlier treated providers and untreated providers. So if there's kind of a heterogeneous treatment effects for those providers, it actually can lead to a biased estimate. And that's, again, something that Dr. Giuseppe Muschelli has written a paper about and is an expert in. Okay, so what is an EPR? There are lots of different types of EPRs. I'm sure most of you kind of know what they are. There are many different suppliers of EPRs. There's additional kind of modules, there's different instances. And essentially it's a system that allows, it does lots of things, but it's a system that allows clinicians to order tests remotely. Once you actually have patients information in terms of the diagnoses for patients, it can also kind of send flags for this patient is likely to have sepsis. So it does a variety of different things. And you can kind of see here the benefit of actually having a staggered model is that we're able to kind of consider the right-hand graph a little bit more and take all the information from each point in time for each provider that has implemented an EPR. Whereas if we treat it all as one go, on the left-hand side, you'll see, I think as it gets to 2020, a lot of them will turn pink. And that's kind of the alternative if you don't use a staggered approach. Now, one of the main kind of benefits of this is that we have like a really nice control and treatment group. So our control group are providers that have never had an EPR, and our treatment group are providers that have never had an EPR, and then within this time period have implemented an EPR, which creates a nice kind of clean counterfactual to compare against when we do our difference in difference modeling. Okay, so I'm going to talk through three separate econometric models that we built in Stata with the help of Giuseppe and also Andrew as well. So I'm going to refer to them as the CSA, the CDH, and the ESTID models. And the references are kind of contained at the bottom. I'm kind of happy to share the code and also the papers for these as well with anyone who's particularly interested. So the first thing that's really important in difference modeling is to make sure that you have parallel trends. So essentially, simplified. It's making sure that your control and treatment providers are sufficiently similar, which then allows you to essentially estimate what would have happened if no EPR had been implemented at your treatment providers. You can essentially model the difference between what you would have expected to have happened if there was no EPR and what actually happened. So what these three models do is they, the first two kind of essentially match you the best possible control available from the data set. And the third model creates a synthetic control. So if we just start with the CSA model. That essentially uses a generalized propensity score to identify the best control provider relative to the treatment provider that is being considered. Again, this is a really new piece of research that only came out in 2021 and has only just been started to be used. This ultimately will estimate the average treatment effect for that treatment provider relative to the control that's being selected, and then it will aggregate the average treatment effects across all treatment providers, as well as testing for parallel trends. The CDH model does something, it's actually very similar in nature to the CSA model, but it does make some adjustments to the two-way fix effects estimator, and also the pre-trends test is slightly different. We found the CDH model to be a little bit less restrictive in terms of identifying parallel trends compared to the CSA model. And the synthetic difference and difference model is our preferred model because it creates a synthetic control that guarantees that you have parallel trends. It essentially is a perfect control for the treatment provider that you're considering against. Which essentially means that you don't have to actually test for parallel trends because that's always the case. But whether it gives you a significant finding is a different question altogether. There are also some additional models that we kind of considered, the Beruzjak model and also the Woolrich and Mudlack model. The Beruzjak model has recently kind of had some more criticism in kind of academic literature, and we're not actually using that, but if you kind of have a similar piece of research that you're doing, you shouldn't necessarily discard it. You should kind of consider what it recommends that you can do, and also the criticism around that. And the Woolrich Mudlack model as well, we think is perhaps a little bit more robust than the Beruzjak approach, but I don't think it's been extensively published or used yet, whereas the three that came in the large box at the top are more regularly used for this type of analysis. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about actually setting up the data set in order to actually run these econometric models. It's not particularly hard to do. So we use UDAL, we use PES patient level data, but it's essential for any of these models to run that you have, as I said, a treatment and a control group. You have a really good counterfactual that you can compare against. Otherwise, it basically won't work. So the data must exist for the treatment and control group over the same time period, and there must be sufficient treatment providers to help reduce the size of the confidence interval down. So we found kind of as we added more treatment providers in, it gave greater certainty to the actual estimates that we were producing. It's really essential. I'm kind of blending point two and point four here, but the panels have to be balanced for the models to work, otherwise you get biased estimates. So if you want to control for things like case mix, so maybe like HRG subchapter, you need to make sure, so let's say you have provider, month, and HRG subchapter, you have to have an entry for each month. Otherwise, the when you balance the panel, it will essentially drop out that data, which is a very big problem and ultimately leads to you sometimes being restricted on controls, especially things like HRG. Ideally, for treatment providers, you would want to have at least 1 year of post-intervention data. Now, EPRs have been rolled out at different points in time, and there are some kind of late adopters as well within our study. So I think we have two that we maybe have 10 months worth of data. So what we've done is for like robustness, we've essentially run the model with those included and again with those removed from the model as well. So that I think took out two treatment providers from our models, but essentially I'll get to the results, but essentially we got a very similar finding whether we did or didn't include them. Okay, I touched a little bit on academic literature and about using HIGs as a control. It's really important that you consider if there are any other appropriate controls that should be applied to the model. If I just jump back to this. So the CSA model, it's essential that for this model, you take a pre-implementation average of the controls. You can't use actual like values for each month. So for example, like we take a yearly average pre-intervention, whereas with the other models, you don't need to do that. So that's just a point of difference about how you actually deal with controls when you run the model. I should stress as well, and we're really keen to kind of share this code. Essentially, we built it in Stata, but it's something that, you know, if you have a similar kind of study that you're working on, you could probably plug and play like with what we have. Okay, so we have a very kind of simplified diagram here, just to make it easy to understand. There are lots of kind of intricacies here that aren't necessarily covered, and I'll get to those. But if we kind of simplistically look at this, you have the three different models kind of on the left-hand side. And so we've kind of boxed them up as a green, best case, orange, medium, red, worst case. So your best case scenario is that you have, your best case scenario is that you have parallel trends holding, i.e. the assumption, and the result is statistically significant. The medium case is that you have one of those, and the worst case is that you have neither, which is very good news. Now, it's quite a simplistic way of looking at it, but also you can look at the ethnic model because you don't have a parallel trends test there because it always holds. You're only considering whether you have a significant result or you don't. Okay. And then at a high level, essentially, if you want to interpret them together on the right hand side, you can basically see there that we give more weight to the synthetic model because we think the control is better. And we would look for another model to have a green finding as well. In terms of categorizing, we think that potentially we could have a useful finding if the estimate is green, or another model is orange, or both CSA and CBH are green, and no finding if none of the above conditions are met. Now, I mentioned there were some kind of intricacies to this, and it's true that with parallel trends, like you might have like 3 years of pre-implementation data. Parallel trends might not hold for that whole 3 year period. It might hold for 6 months or 9 months prior. So at that point, you need to kind of make a judgment as to how reliable you think the results are based on how strong your parallel trends are before you have the intervention. Also, some of your models may pass some of these tests if you run them with covariates, and if you run them without, then maybe they won't. If you aggregate by monthly or by quarterly or annually, if you're looking at a longer time series, they may pass, they may not. And that's where we've relied on Giuseppe to kind of help us navigate that kind of more tricky, kind of the more tricky nuances around considering the models together. There's some kind of general rules as well on the right-hand side. I've talked kind of about these a little bit already. Important to consider kind of how you're aggregating the models, so monthly or quarterly. In terms of actually running the model, so the synthetic model and the CDH model, you need to run this with a minimum of 500 bootstrap repetitions, ideally 1,000 if you can do that on your health. All these models run at a 95% confidence interval. You can manually change that in Stata, but the problem is because they're brand new packages, there's no option to actually adjust that within the package at the moment that we've yet found. So all of these results are taken at 95%. It's important to set the seed to obtain the same random numbers so you can have reproducible results. And as I kind of mentioned, there are other models that you might want to consider as well. Okay, so now I'm going to get to findings. I'll just see how long I've got left. Okay. All right, so this is where I think it maybe gets a little bit more interesting. So this is our first, technically our kind of our second finding. We've looked at a lot of different things, and there's quite a wide array of academic literature that suggests EPRs do good things across a lot of different kind of patient cohorts. And so we've kind of looked to draw out a couple. So the first one is sepsis mortality. I mentioned at the start that essentially there's a flag that's built into some EPR systems that essentially patients present, it's like an algorithm, and patients present specific kind of conditions, and it flags that they might be at higher risk of actually having sepsis, and then it tells the clinician to check for that. And so, yeah, our analytical period, we've looked between April 2018 to January 2023. We have 16 control providers, 8 treatment providers, and we've aggregated the data monthly. In terms of the outcome variable, we've taken the average mortality rate from sepsis, obviously. Group level, so we've grouped it by provider, and that actually, we haven't actually grouped this by HLU subchapter, because when we balance the panel, it kicked out too much data. And we have one control in this model, which makes kind of a little bit of difference to the results, but it's broadly very similar. For if a patient is aged over 75 years old. A really important distinction for this is that we've looked at surgical patients, surgical specialty patients only, based on clinical advice from colleagues that work with the frontline digitization team. Great, and so you can kind of see that the code and the models, they spit out some kind of nice graphs that you're able to kind of consider and potentially use. But the main finding is that essentially the outcomes lead to an annual 3.3 percentage point reduction in sepsis mortality. And we found for this cohort, it's essentially the actual sepsis mortality rate is around 11.3%. So materially, that's a very big reduction in average sepsis mortality. We think that could potentially save hundreds of lives a year if these are being implemented at trusts that do not have EPRs or have a very limited EPR in terms of quality. So potentially quite an exciting result. And yeah, we could also convert that into qualies if you want to include it in business cases. Okay. And finally, inpatient length of stay. So obviously there's a lot of pressure on waiting lists and elective care. And essentially, there's kind of a lot of pressure from above for us to look at inpatient care. And whether EPRs lead to a reduction in length of stay. You'll see that the kind of information is very similar in this model to the model that I've just been through. Essentially, I think we have one less treatment provider because of data quality issues. The big differences, I suppose, are that this is this contains 4 controls. So the HRG, the case mix, and then age, sex, and ethnicity. Okay, so the key findings here, we basically were able to find through this kind of causal model that introducing EPRs led to a 6% ranging between 2% and 10% reduction in non-elective inpatient length of stay. So we project that if EPRs are rolled out, similarly as I described sepsis, if they're rolled out at providers that don't have them, or that have a really limited EPR where we reduce down the size of this impact, we think that could release between 558 and 2,788 beds annually, with the midpoint or the point estimate being equivalent to about 2 hospitals worth of patient beds, which would materially reduce things like waiting times, depending on how the providers decided they wanted to use that additional capacity. I think that is pretty much. Yeah, pretty much all I want to say, but thanks everyone.
It's going to be another very well timed talk. And full disclosure, I should say that Tony and Andrew have to stay in my team, so I know that they have been living and breathing for a very long time. And I think that probably, very, very pleasing to see the results. Can I open up to any questions, please?
You had a little, so Will Bryan from Gretton Street Hospital said we have an EPR and we may be in that place, I'm not sure.
Congratulations.
I wonder, you mentioned saving lives and turning that into a kind of value proposition in business cases. We're super keen on operational analytics and improving the way that we run after we're using data. one of the challenges is if we're improving care and improving outcomes, how do we translate that into a sort of value proposition against generating efficiencies in like lab over testing or something like that, and how we decide how to focus our energy as analysts?
Yeah, so one of the approaches that we kind of typically take when supporting business cases to kind of support investment in things kind of similar to this is looking at quality adjusted life years, so quality analysis. And this is actually something that we plan to do with the sepsis work, essentially converting this into how many people would we have expected to have died over the next, say, 5 years in your hospital, in your provider, right? How many would we have expected to have died? How many? So how many would have expected to have died? What would their average life expectancy have been? Therefore, how many lives have you saved? And then you can essentially convert that based on the quality of life that those patients would have expected on average to have experienced over those additional life years. And then, yeah, you can multiply that through by the quality value. And then that there is your societal benefit of investing in APIs.
Okay, thank you.
Hi, somebody who spent a lot of their working on implementing EPRs. I'm just interested to know how, I might have missed this at the beginning, how are you defining the functionality within the EPRs? You talked about limited or full scale, or noticing you're talking about sepsis, something not new stores in.
Yeah.
Did you look at any variables around that?
Yeah, so the frontline digitization team have quite extensive information about which providers have what generation of EPR. So we've considered, I think they're split into four broad categories. I think group zero, group one, basically like they don't have an EPR. Yeah. I think group two have like a first generation EPR, and then group three is considered like a pretty good EPR. And so we're essentially modeling moving from zero, group zero, group one to group three in this scenario. So like having a better.
Have you thought about applying this to the HIMSS digital maturity?
Yeah, so there's a brand new digital maturity assessment that we are actually getting the results from very soon. So this is something that we could kind of incorporate. An exciting kind of offshoot of this analysis would be to look at a marginal improvement in EPR. So not just looking at whether you have one or you don't, whether you move from kind of having a not so good one to a one that's a bit better. And realistically, we would kind of have controls and treatments for that.
I look forward to that.
Any further questions?
Did you do any special compensation for COVID? And the reason I ask that is completely anecdotally, there's the theory that a lot of those who are good with EPRs will be often well organized trusts, and COVID being quite an extraordinary event. I don't know if you did you do any kind of.
So I think that one of the really good things about this modeling approach is because we have EPRs implemented before, during, and after, and we take the average treatment effect across all of those, first the control, who also we have data for through the COVID period, you would expect it to match to a control that is most appropriate for the treatment provider, and you have an average effect anyway. So I don't think you would need to actually specifically control for that. I think it's already kind of controlled for within the analysis.
Any other questions for
I know we went through a long implementation phase. We were kind of setting up our EPR, and then a long optimization phase where we were bedding it in. Do you take that into account? Do you think you can work and model that through this time?
Yeah, so one of the things we looked at was whether we looked at loads of things. This is the two that we've kind of got results for. We looked at whether activity changed as a result of introducing EPR, because anecdotally, people say, oh, you know, there's a big, it's very disruptive initially for the first, you know, 2-3 months, and then actually it recovers. We found that, but we weren't really able to prove that. Sorry, I may not have quite answered your question there.
Oh, no, well, I mean, it's really interesting, especially when you're thinking about the, you know, the way that people use them.
Yeah.
And how you realize the benefit from it.
Something that you can do with these models, which is really good for some specific interventions, you can put in an anticipation period, and you can build that into the actual model, which essentially delays your implementation, I think. But we've not done that for any of these, because for things like sepsis mortality and inpatient length of stay, we don't think it would that would really matter for these, but for activity it might.
And you have, like you say, seen some interesting results where as a player, it's received with them, it's very instructive to implement an ETR.
Yeah.
But actually, you can kind of put numbers to that and you can say, well, yes, it's not the one we can think. You can anticipate it's going to take this many months. And therefore, you can actually plan your implementation around other things that you know are going on accordingly.
Yeah, exactly. We kind of found out those for maybe six months. And we saw like a level of disruption and then kind of back to roughly the activity levels that you were expecting. But we weren't able to kind of essentially prove that.
And of course, once it is implemented, you start seeing the benefits as well that you've just really interesting. I did have a question for you. have you got kind of other areas where you thought like this kind of as you say, very, very new models, some of them already published in 2021. Have you got ideas of where else potentially could have benefit when studying implementation in the NHS?
Yeah, I mean, I think any sort of rollout where it's not essentially rolled out at the same point in time and you have the control and you have a treatment group, I mean, it's very applicable to a lot of other things that teams kind of work on. I suppose the main kind of standout thing to me is that I've seen a lot of studies that use like the two-way fixed effects model. It's been quite interesting to kind of learn why that might not always be the best approach and that actually there are alternatives available that you can compare against.
And I guess the other thing that I found quite unusual or unique about this project is the relationship that you have with the Giuseppe, the academic that we've kind of built this relationship with, which traditionally as NHS analysts, we don't necessarily have that kind of informal kind of relationship in order to, you know, QA and discuss the work. How has that been? And do you think that has been essential to this because it's quite a new area? And do you see that perhaps in time wouldn't be so necessary?
Yeah, I mean, so he's a specialist in econometrics and in like staggered difference in different models. It's literally his bag, like he's written papers about it. So he's the perfect person to have supporting this project. And me and Andrew started off with the CSA model, and then he suggested four of the models after discussions with other academics. So we've essentially gone through all of the models that he's recommended. Yeah, it's been incredibly useful.
Yeah. Any questions for Toby before we wrap this session and move on to the next one? If not, please can I join me to thank you.
Thanks, everyone.